Robert Schumann was one of the great composers of the last century. Like his fellow romantics, he filled his works with imagination and feeling. But just as his shyness and his moodiness made him stand apart from people, so his music too stands apart and sounds a unique, lyrical, and intimate note. His canvases are smaller than those of his contemporaries. They're less crowded. They're sometimes painted with more delicate colors and with less sweeping brush strokes. His is an art that poetically and sensitively suggests different emotional states.
Ich grolle nicht, und wenn das Herz auch bricht, ewig verlorenes Lieb, ewig verlorenes Lieb, ich grolle nicht. Strahlst in Diamantenpracht, es fällt kein Strahl in deines Herzens Nacht, das weiß ich längst. Ich grolle nicht, und wenn das Herz auch bricht, ich sah dich ja im Traume, und sah die Nacht in deines Herzens Raume, und sah die Schlange, die dir am Herzen frisst. Ich sah, mein Lieb, wie sehr du elend bist. Ich grolle nicht, ich grolle nicht.
While others sought romance in traveling to far-off places, or in dreaming of times that had long since passed, Schumann found it in the simple pleasures of happy domestic life. While others hung desperately to their youth and dressed in the height of fashion, he found true beauty in simple comforts and in enjoying the sight of his children growing up around him. It's his naturalness and gentleness that set him apart from most of the composers of his time. Schumann, who was so gentle in everything else, could be fierce and intense about music, the thing that mattered most to him. At the height of joy, or in the depths of despair and illness, he never stopped composing. In order to become a musician, he went against the wishes of his mother, whom he loved dearly. To acquire greater skill on the piano, he often carried with him a dummy keyboard on which he constantly practiced. He invented a device to improve his reach and his touch, but it had an unhappy result. It permanently crippled one of his fingers. natural to assume that a man so absorbed in music, so interested in privacy, and with such a simple formula for personal happiness, would have led a dull and uneventful life. But the excitement that Schumann tried to avoid seemed to seek him out. This man, who was a failure as a teacher and conductor, because he was so uncomfortable with people and could not impose his will on them, was forced to become a fighter despite himself. He had to fight for his art, for his beloved wife, and finally for his very sanity. For someone who wanted only peace and quiet, Schumann lived a life that would make a remarkable drama. In a sense, Schumann could not help being involved in the world of struggle, because there were two sides to his personality. One thoughtful, retiring, and tender, the other reckless and energetic. Schumann himself, recognizing this, whimsically called himself by two names, Eusebius for his more pensive moods, and Florestan for his more dramatic ones. He signed a number of his compositions E or F, depending upon which part of his personality had inspired him. This is the way Schumann pictured Eusebius in music. This contrasting gay section he labeled Florestan. Elements in his makeup, however, did not always go their separate ways. They are often heard together in the same composition. Thank you. Oddly enough, Schumann became famous as a music critic before he was known as a composer. It seemed to him to be a waste of time to compose when he knew that the public was turning to music which had nothing to recommend it but prettiness or tricky effects. Both as Eusebius and Florestan, he wanted to raise the level of musical taste, to encourage artists who had new ideas, and to restore Beethoven and Schubert to public honor. So he founded a magazine which, in time, re-established the importance of Bach, was instrumental in having Schubert's music performed, and brought into the public spotlight Chopin, Berlioz, and Brahms. Schumann described himself as a modern David, leading the fight against the uncultured Philistines. He even wrote a march for this quite imaginary society of David and the Friends of Art. At the same time as he filled the pages of his musical magazine, he composed many charming piano works that are filled with autobiographical details. The form of these is unusual, because each one consists of a number of brief musical scenes held together by a poetic idea. For example, there's his Carnival, which describes a fancy dress ball attended by some masked figures representing drama, some of his friends, some of his musical idols, and his own two personalities. Each one emerges for a moment from the gay, laughing crowd. Here's a tumbling clown with his painted smile. Next comes Harlequin, leaping and pirouetting. We hear the graceful waltz to which the couples are dancing. Chopin appears in a musical imitation of his style. One of the figures has a bold but graceful melody. She is Chiarina, a poetic disguise for Clara, who was soon to be so important in Schumann's life. Clara was a 9-year-old piano prodigy when Schumann, then 18, first saw her. She was the daughter of Frederick Wieck, a famous piano teacher. He had such faith in Schumann's skill that he had him live in the same house with him in order to supervise his studies. One result of the association was that Schumann became a master composer for the piano, and for 10 years, between 1830 and 1840, he expressed himself solely on that instrument. The other result was that he fell in love with the 17-year-old Clara. He never did become a performer, because he had crippled his finger shortly after beginning his studies. Refused to consider the penniless Schumann as a husband for Clara. He foresaw, quite correctly, that she would become an outstanding pianist. He didn't want an early marriage and children to stand in the way of a brilliant career. For 4 years, Clara and Robert were separated. Wieck forbade letters and visits. He even went to the extent of blackening Schumann's name in public, but he was silenced by a court order. As a last resort, he threw his daughter out without a dowry. During those years, they communicated with each other through music. She would play at a concert, a work Robert had dedicated to her, and he would publish a work in which she could imagine him assuring her that all would be well.
Thank you.
Clara may very well have read a secret message in his Fantasia, where he repeats a phrase from Beethoven's To a Distant Beloved. The words at that point in the original song were, "Take these songs I sing, beloved." On Clara's 21st birthday, their marriage took place. To express the joy that filled his heart, Schumann turned to poetry and the human voice. But the piano is not neglected. It's not just an accompaniment in his songs. It sheds additional meaning on the words. Rarely before this had the text and the quality of its emotion shaped the music so completely. The song cycle Dichterliebe catches the many moods of a lover. One of the 16 songs tells how, in the lovely month of May, when spring is everywhere, the lover must sing of his love.
Im wunderschönen Monat Mai, als alle Knospen sprangen, da ist in meinem Herzen die Liebe aufgegangen.
In another song, the lover is so overwhelmed by his emotions that he can pay no attention to the beauties of spring. He can think only of his sweetheart.
Die Rose, die Lilie, die Taube, die Sonne, die lieb ich als alle in Liebeswonne. Ich lieb sie nicht mehr, ich liebe alleine die Kleine, die Feine, die Reine, die Eine. Sie selber aller Liebe Wonne ist Rose und Lilie und Taube und Sonne. Ich liebe alleine die Kleine, die Feine, die Reine, die Eine, die Eine.
There is no more perfect monument to the beauty of the relationship between Robert and Clara Schumann than the 140 songs he wrote in little more than a year. Love made Schumann understand not only himself, but it also gave him deeper insight into a woman's heart. In a tender song cycle, he told of a girl's growth to maturity through love. One of the 8 songs pictured her gladness on discovering that he, the most wonderful of men, should have found something in her to admire.
Ihr der herrlichste von allen, wie so mir. wie dort in blauer Tiefe hell und herrlich jener Stern. Also ihr an meinem Himmel hell und herrlich hier und fern. Wandle, wandle deine Bahnen, nur betrachte meinen Schein. Nur in Demut ihn betrachte, selig nur und traurig sein. Höre nicht mein stilles Bitten.
Later in the cycle, the girl becomes a bride, the ring on her finger promising companionship and emotional security, brings serenity to her voice.
Du Ring an meinem Finger, mein goldenes Ringelein, ich drücke dich fromm an die Lippen, dich fromm an die Lippen, an das Herz mein. Ich hatt ihn ausgeträumet, der Kindheit friedlich schönen Traum. Ich fand allein mich verloren im öden unendlichen Raum.
As Schumann's life grew more complex, he looked for bigger and richer musical forms to carry his thoughts. The first 10 years of piano music were followed by a joyous year of songwriting. Next, he felt the need of the orchestra and the symphonic form. His first symphony is as romantic in theme as one would expect from him. Spring blows her trumpets to waken new life in the sleeping earth. It was not easy for a composer whose instrument was the piano to adjust to orchestral writing. He felt more at home where the piano was featured. His piano concerto was an outstanding success. Its popularity was increased because Clara Schumann played it in all the capitals of Europe. By this time, Schumann was in his early 30s. His health had never been good. The strain of uninterrupted writing and composing at fever pitch may have caused his nervous breakdown, the first of several. There were other factors. First, his inability to meet financial obligations, especially since his family kept growing larger. And then his morbid dread of being called the husband of Clara Schumann. In his day, as well as in ours, a performing artist received more publicity than a composer. And then when, in addition, a number of his friends and relatives died at about this same time, it was too much for his high-strung nature to bear. For a while, nothing could rouse him from his depression. As he himself described it, "dark spirits haunted me." Then, slowly, his health returned, and with it a definitely cheerful outlook. During his enforced periods of rest, Schumann enjoyed to the full the company of his large family. He had 8 children, the youngest named Felix after his good friend, the composer Mendelssohn. With his children, he forgot to be absent-minded or gloomy. They made him remember his own pleasant childhood, which had been the inspiration for an early set of piano pieces. And here you'll find the melody known as Träumerei, filled with youthful daydreams. Now he turned his attention to composing an album of piano pieces for his own children, which would carry them in easy stages to more difficult material. At a time when piano students were taught mainly by dull exercises, he realized the importance of letting the child learn and have fun at the same time. His attractive pieces are now played by young students all over the world. The Hunting Song, for example, recreates a vivid scene. The Merry Peasant, also called The Happy Farmer, is one of his most popular numbers. It's no chore to learn to play the pretty melody of the spring song called Beautiful May. Schumann called one piece The Stranger, and he filled it with exciting mystery. What the mystery is, each listener must supply for himself. Like a good teacher, Schumann deliberately gave no title to several of the pieces. It was up to the child to decide what the selection meant to him. Schumann's last years were darkened by an increasing melancholy. He rarely spoke. He heard imaginary sounds and voices. Finally, he attempted suicide. He was rescued, but he died insane soon after, at the age of 46. Between attacks of his illness, he continued to compose symphonies, chamber works, and even an opera. For 40 years after his death, Clara devotedly kept her husband's music before the public on her concert tours. Schumannesque is now used of other composers if their music is gentle and song-like, or if it catches impressions of people or of nature, as in this lovely work. Thank you. Schumannesque also suggests humor or irony. Here's Schumann's rather comic version of a clumsy peasant dance. Schumann tends to be remembered best for his brief piano and vocal pieces. His larger works should not be overlooked, however. They have passages of alternating buoyancy and pathos that are typical of the man. Schumann fought all his life against the cheap and the superficial. His own works helped to give meaning and stature to what we call the Romantic movement in music. Thank you.